staff and staff is.
Jessica Sammons, Legislative Analysis. Yes, you are remembering that correctly. That was Senate Bill 747 from 2023.
Follow-up?
Yes, you're recognized for follow-up. And Representative Harrison, do you have several
questions? If you don't mind, just...
Yeah, you're recognized for a series of questions to the bill sponsor or to staff.
Yeah, I appreciate that. I guess my biggest concern about this is, why is it necessary? It may cause public confusion, may be expensive to add it to the ballot. They're going to have a crowded ballot, and lots of folks are going to, you know, I don't even know if they're going to get there. I just trying to prove a point that we actually have pretty clear state law right now and pretty clear constitutional provisions that non-citizens can't vote. Ms. Sammons, is it accurate? So the provision in Senate Bill 747 clarifies whatever confusion there might be about non-citizens voting. I know it was a provision in that bill. I guess the point needed to be made, but was the point made?
The provisions in Senate Bill 747 codified the holding in Hinton versus Hinton regarding United States citizenship as a qualification for jury service. So, and it also established a process for the removal of non-citizens that have an excuse for jury duty on the basis that they are not citizens from their voter registration rolls. So that issue dealt with who is allowed to serve on jury, as well as the process for if someone says that they are not a U.S. citizen, to be removed from the jury pool, that then gives that information over so that they can be removed from the voter registration through the list maintenance process conducted by the State Board of Elections.
I appreciate that. I just keep following up. Is that okay? Because I don't want to drag this out. It's late. So there's nothing in that provision that deals with the voting piece or how non-citizens are identified or defined. I'm gonna let you if you need time to look at it, I'll let you, and I will ask my other questions.
So that the Section 44 of Senate Bill 747 from last session had a application process for a form that has to be developed and furnished by AOC, and that information is all done by AOC in terms of the excusals from jury duty. And my understanding is that that is more geared towards the clerk of superior court would record the information, list the reason for disqualification for jury duty, and then if that information is said that the person is disqualified from jury duty because they are not a citizen of the United States, they would communicate that information to the state board. The state board would then conduct efforts to remove the names from the list of registered voters. That's more dealing with the person stating that they are should not be serving on jury duty because they're not a U.S. citizen, not so much the registering to vote aspect of it, but that information is then used for list maintenance for voter registration.
I appreciate that. So my follow-up, Representative Hall mentioned the cities around the country that are allowing non-citizens to vote. I remember there's some in Vermont, and I think maybe Washington, D.C., maybe some in California. In North Carolina, are cities in a position to allow non-citizens to vote? If they wanted to do it on their own.
Is that a question for Representative Hall?
If it's either for Representative Hall or staff, whichever.
Well, I think that certainly that would be challenged and litigated in court. And as we've seen, unfortunately, in my opinion, in large part, it seems that politics is playing more and more of a role in the judiciary. We had a case a couple, maybe 3 or 4 years ago now, about redistricting that the Supreme Court made in 2021, I believe, that I thought was completely outside the bounds of anything that was actually in the written Constitution. And I imagine, Representative Harrison, you would disagree with me on that. And that's the whole point here, is that there should not be any disagreement in one of the most fundamental parts of the Constitution, that is, who should vote. There currently is a number of ambiguities in the current Constitution on the provision that we're talking about. One example of that is the Constitution says every person born in the United States. And so, for example, let's say a foreign official is here, an ambassador from name some country in the world. They're born here, and under federal law, it says that if you're born here and subject to the jurisdiction thereof, you can become a citizen. Well, our Constitution just says if you're born here. So presumably, and I don't think this has been litigated in the North Carolina Supreme Court, as far as I'm aware, if a foreign official's child was born here in North Carolina, they would have some argument that they should be allowed to vote in North Carolina if they meet the other requirements about living here in North Carolina as well. And how often is that going to come up? Well, it certainly could. Would it be high numbers? But again, that's the point, is that there is an ambiguity here. And I think that certainly my opinion is, if I were arguing in court, in front of a court, I would say, you know, judge, you should find that only citizens can vote in North Carolina. But I would not be shocked to find that maybe folks who disagree with me politically on the other side of the spectrum would find, no, this is not clear. We should interpret this in a way that allows more people to be able to vote, and therefore make a decision that this Constitution does not only require citizens to vote. It just sets out that's one set of folks who can vote. And again, the language in this amendment makes it absolutely crystal clear, I think beyond any reasonable doubt, that, again, as it says, only a citizen is able to vote.
I appreciate that. I promise, I'm not going to dominate. I'm interested in your point about maybe the child of an ambassador, in your hypothetical, a child of an ambassador being born here. Wouldn't the 14th Amendment give that? I mean, I know there's a debate about that at the national level, but wouldn't the 14th Amendment give that birthright citizenship? And it seems like that would extend to North Carolina.
Yeah. So the federal Constitution again says that you're born here and subject to the jurisdiction thereof. And as I understand it, the Supreme Court, U.S. Supreme Court at some point in the past has said those children would not be subject to the jurisdiction thereof. And so, again, the fact that we're having a debate right now about what those words mean, again, is the entire point of this amendment, because it's really not a debate that we want to have in court. We want the folks of the state to know who can and cannot vote.
I appreciate that. I guess question for you or for the staff, but right now, if I understand correctly, there are state laws that criminalize encouraging non-citizens to register or vote. There are state laws. North Carolina has state laws that criminalize encouraging a non-citizen to register to vote or vote. Is that correct, of staff or I don't mean to keep grilling you.
Can you clarify that again? What were you asking?
Do we have state laws, North Carolina state laws, that criminalize encouraging a non-citizen to register or to vote?
Well, we should. If we don't, be glad to be on that bill with you, but I will defer to staff.
If staff has...
I'll give you a hint. General Statute 163-275, parens 18, close parens, class 1 felony.
Okay.
I'm not trying to be obnoxious. I understand there are also federal laws that criminalize registering or voting by non-citizens. That's in the U.S. Code, and there are civil penalties. I feel like we're chasing a problem that doesn't exist. I remember these debates even back during Deborah Ross's days on this committee. The penalties that come with voting as a non-citizen are scary to the non-citizen, and it just seems like we are creating a situation that might be chilling new citizens' desire to vote. I don't like the signal this is sending. I know it's part of an effort that seems to be going on nationally. I think it's pretty clear in our Constitution that non-citizens can't vote. I don't know why we need to be going through this. I know there's an expense, as I said, with putting a constitutional amendment on the ballot. It's going to be a crowded ballot in 2024. I'm just very concerned about the signal this is sending to our new citizens in North Carolina. I'm going to close it there. Thank you. I appreciate your efforts.
Thank you, Representative Harrison. We'll see if Representative Hall wants to respond to that before we move on to the next question.
I always enjoyed debating Representative Harrison. I won't belabor the point, but we'll agree to disagree.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. And Representative Ball, I saw you next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. In regards to the points that have been made that there's a cost related to putting something on the ballot, did you have a fiscal note done on this? Can staff indicate to us what that might indicate and so forth? And if I might, or I can do a follow-up, or I can just ask both questions.
You're recognized for a series of questions.
Okay, all right.
So
I'll let that one go.
Number two.
You wouldn't.
There's no fiscal note, but you can ask staff if they have any idea what it costs to print an extra bit of ballot.
Staff is recognized if they care to respond.
Representative Ball, I do not know the answer off the top of my head. I'll be happy to look into that and get back to you.
I would appreciate it because I think the public needs to understand that. And to that point, my second question would be, have we made any arrangements? Are we going to make any arrangements should this bill pass to educate the public as to why we believe we need this on in our Constitution? And what would that cost be?
I certainly would advocate for that sort of voter education. I know I know we've changed this rule in recent history about the commission or whatever the entity is that tries to go out and educate folks on constitutional amendments. We had several in 2018 that did that. And so I think the State Board of Elections still has the capability of doing that, but we certainly would want to go out and educate folks on why we want to do this.
Follow up.
Thank you for one quick follow up. So you would agree that needs to be done? And should be included in any statements that we put out, should this pass, that there needs to be money appropriated if it's not already there to educate the citizens of the state?
Well, we appropriate a lot of money to the Board of Elections in this state. And, you know, certainly I think every member of this body is incumbent upon them to go out and try to educate voters as they can. I think I would also submit this is a relatively simple amendment that I think overwhelmingly people of the state will agree with. I think the Board of Elections has the funds to do that, but certainly if they don't, that's a discussion we'd be willing to have with them.
Representative Buonzi, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
Question really for staff, if that's
yes,
all right.
That's fine.
All right. So just want to be clear, but are there currently any localities in North Carolina, cities or towns or counties that are seeking to allow non-citizens to vote?
Staff's recognized.
I am not aware of any. I don't have that information, but to my knowledge, I have not heard of any.
Follow up?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
And in order for that to happen, would the state legislature need to authorize that?
If you have a response, if not, we can try to get them one.
Yeah. So right now, the Constitution does say every person born in the United States and every person who has been naturalized and who is 18 years of age and possessing the qualifications shall be entitled to vote. I think how that is interpreted would have to be argued in court.
Okay. And just so I'm clear, I mean, currently under our Constitution, currently under our state law, is it unlawful for a non-citizen to vote in North Carolina?
If you have a response, you're free to respond.
So, like I said, the Constitution does say every person born in the United States and every person who has been naturalized and possessing the qualifications set out in this article shall be entitled to vote. Chapter 163 of the General Statutes through the voter registration application does have a box that the person has to sign and attest that they are a U.S. citizen in order to register to vote. And making that attestation on the voter registration form and signing it, you are saying that you are a U.S. citizen, and it would be a violation of that and if you were falsely giving that information.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Yes. Representative Dixon, you're recognized.
With all due respect, I don't think this is a time for the staff to educate us.
Noted, Representative Dixon. Thank you. Representative Baker, you're recognized. You're good. Okay, Representative Warren, you're next.
I wasn't sure you'd see me raise my hand. Yeah, just in this context, what is the definition of citizen so we can just make a distinction between citizen and residence? In this context, what is the appropriate definition of citizen?
Representative Hall's
right. I'm glad to, but almost with great trepidation, I would ask you to ask staff what the definition of citizen is. I would say, Representative Warren, certainly under our law in North Carolina, you know, a citizen is someone who has a right to citizenship, whether that be through they were, you know, born here or whether they were a naturalized citizen. I think that there's no argument that someone who is not here and having this legal status of citizenship would fall under the word citizen in this constitutional amendment. So it wouldn't apply to someone who may have legal resident status, for example, but they're not a citizen. Certainly would not apply to someone who is here without any sort of legal resident status. I don't think there's much of an argument against that point anyway.
Okay. Representative Dahl, you recognize?
So I have now had, I do have a question. I have now had several naturalized citizens come up and ask me if they can vote. So this concerns me because it's the definition is not clear. And I don't think, number one, I was quoted as saying, I think it's the funniest bill in the world because if you're a citizen, you can vote. So I'm not really sure why we're clarifying it at this very moment. And I wondered if you could answer why we, other than litigation, I know there's been some stupid things in court. I realize that, but I just cannot. I'm having a hard time seeing a throng of people going and filing a case to vote. That would make, I don't know how they could do that with our other laws in place. So I'm really confused as to why we need to do this. And my second question would be, if in fact this bill does move forward, would you be amenable to an amendment that says who is 18 years of age and every person who has been naturalized?
So as to the naturalization question, I think it's pretty clear in the law that if you are naturalized, that you are a citizen. So a citizen is someone who is a citizen other than being naturalized and then somebody who's naturalized, which is why the current version doesn't, it says naturalized, of course. And so to answer your question, yeah, I mean, certainly we can look into that, see if there is any ambiguity and anything we can do to clear up, to make it clear that only citizens, which includes naturalized citizens, are able to vote. I would certainly be open to that if there is some ambiguity there. As to the second question, you know, we live in a time right now where millions, if not tens of millions of people have crossed our southern border from countries all over the world in the last 3.5 years or so. And I'm not, that's not a revelation. It's on the news every day. But in conjunction with that, you see a lot of jurisdictions in our country, including Washington, D.C., the capital of this country, allowing non-citizens to vote. And so just like many big political changes, it may start small. It may start in one place and then it spreads over time. There are undoubtedly those in the country, obviously in D.C. and other cities across the country, who advocate to allow non-citizens to vote. They say, well, they live here, so you ought to let them vote. That's the argument that they're making. So I think under our current statutes, it would be hard for a jurisdiction to change their law to allow a non-citizen to vote. But statutes are easier to change than the Constitution is. And that's why we seek to do this through the Constitution, to make sure that we make it clear in our governing legal document in this state, only citizens. That way, you know, this body in the future, if it decides it wants non-citizens to vote, It's got to take that to the people, because I think that most people in this country believe that only citizens should vote. I think a lot of people would be surprised to find that places like D.C. allow non-citizen voting. So it's getting in front of a tide of, number one, illegal immigration in this country, and also folks who are advocating to allow folks who are here and not citizens to be able to vote, and making sure that we get in front of that in North Carolina and don't have a problem.
Yes, ma'am.
So, I totally understand. I mean, I don't agree with, but totally understand where you're coming from. We passed a law last session that said you have to have an ID, and we named all of those IDs, and all of those IDs are proof of citizenship. So why would we then change something? I mean, we have, you can't get a driver's license if you're here on an HB1 visa or if you're here illegally. You have to be here legally and you have to show documentation. So that means they're legally here. Now, they could be on a student visa, but that is denoted on their, it's denoted on your license because your license is temporary. So I think we're I just feel like we're continually duplicating against some fear that may be out there somewhere. And I'm not sure why we're making laws based on fear. I'm afraid that we're getting into a really sticky place.
So, well, I think to answer the first technical question, there are certainly IDs that folks who are not citizens can obtain, and they can legally do that. I mean, it's not saying they're doing anything improper. They can go get an ID of one of the sorts that are allowed under our current law, not a driver's license, but a number of, if you pull out the list, and I'll let staff list put out the list of permissible IDs. Certainly somebody who is not here and a citizen, that doesn't mean they're here illegally necessarily, but they're here and they're a citizen, can get some form of an ID that would be permissible. And that doesn't mean that they could vote at the end of the day. In addition to that, voter ID was passed in this state in 2018 in the Constitution. It was passed statutorily before that. We've now been able to use that in two elections since 2018. We've had more than two elections since 2018, and that all has been tied up in court, I think unjustifiably so, because the people of the state passed it. I think the statutes that we passed on voter ID are some of the most common type of statutes that you see across the country. Most states in this country have voter ID, and that's all been held up. And again, that brings me back to my point of making sure the language is clear in this amendment, because if it's litigated in state or even federal court, depending on what the situation is. Frankly, I think it depends on, in many ways, the political persuasion of some judges. I think we certainly have activist judges across the country, and all we can do is make the language as clear as we possibly can. And that's what this seeks to do.
Representative Willis, you're recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, I'm going to speak on behalf of my number one constituent, and that's my wife. As a legal immigrant and a naturalized citizen to this country, you know, we spent a lot of time in the AAPI community, and a lot of folks who have immigrated and become naturalized citizens in this country take our voting rights and the sanctity of being able to actually vote, coming from countries that are police states, coming from countries that are communist and you're told what to do, when to do. There's no voice. There's no citizens' rights. You're just rubber stamping, the next dictator in charge. They take our voting process and the right that they have and the privilege that they have to go and vote more seriously than most of our naturally born citizens. And it's shocking to me that we can sit here and spend an hour debating something as simple as this, that every single one of those folks that step across that line and wave their little flag when they get it and they get their naturalized paperwork are so proud to be part of a country that allows them to participate and to do this. And to just simply want to put into language that only citizens who are here and here legally, can do that and have the right and the privilege to do so is controversial. It's just astounding to me. We need to pass this and we need to pass it now. I appreciate your support.
Thank you, Representative Willis. I believe that concludes members. Representative Eiler, you're recognized.
My question can be answered offline with the staff, but in interest of time, I'll make a motion if nobody else is in line to do it.
Can we hold the motion till, and I'll recognize you for the motion, until after public comment. We do have four members from the public, and we're going to let them address us for a minute each. So we'll hold the motion. We do have four people from the public who did sign up to speak earlier today. When I call your name, if you would, please, there'll be a microphone at the back and you may stand at the podium. You will have up to 1 minute. We'll need you to tell us your name. And if you're with an organization, please tell us the organization you're with, or if you're an individual, just your county of residence. And the first name that I have is Akeric McCain, I believe. I apologize if I mispronounce any names. I'm reading handwritten notes here, so I apologize. Yes, sir, if you would, please introduce yourself, and you have up to 1 minute.
But thank you, Chairman Mills, and thank you, Vice Chair Dahl, for allowing me to speak. My name's Kevrick McCain. I'm the State Director for Americans for Citizens Voting, and I actually urge you all to pass HB 1074. And I ask you to pass that really for, I believe that non-citizens voting is important for three reasons. One, it reaffirms a fundamental American right that only citizens can determine their elected representatives. Two, a constitutional amendment gives we the people the right to weigh in on our state's law instead of letting the state be vulnerable to interpretations. And lastly, the bill protects the power of my vote. I'm the great-grandson of Ethel Branch, who left this state in the 1920s and never returned. She never returned to Wake Forest because at that time, Wake Forest, a black person couldn't vote. And so many of the people of our state were scorched with discrimination. Our vote is precious. I ask us to value that vote. Thank you for my time.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate your comments. The next person for comments from the public is Mark Swallow, I believe. Sir, if you would, please introduce yourself, tell us who you are, any organization, or your county of residence. Thank you. Up to 1 minute, sir.
Thank you. My name is Mark Swallow, Wake County. Can anyone here tell me any data that would support non-citizens voting in our elections? Is there any data that supports that?
You're recognized for comment, sir.
Well, that's my comment. I've been a poll worker since I retired in 2019. There are no non-citizens voting in our elections. So what are we doing here? There are real problems being faced in our state, and we need you to send your time and energy and talents focusing on that legislation, not this legislation. This is not solving a problem. Please solve the problems we have, like childcare virtually expiring, government workers that are providing services that don't exist because they're not being hired. Please focus on the right stuff. This is not it.
Thank you, sir. Next on our list is Andy Jackson. Welcome to House Elections. You have up to 1 minute, sir. Please introduce yourself.
Thank you for having me. I'm Andy Jackson with the John Locke Foundation. I speak in favor of House Bill 1074. Who possesses the right to influence policy in our state through voting is a fundamental question that should be unambiguously addressed in our Constitution. North Carolina law currently does limit voter registration to citizens. However, temporary legislative majorities or temporary judicial majorities can brush those protections aside. A constitutional amendment stating unequivocally that only citizens of the United States may vote would protect our current understanding. As a quick aside, I will say that our current language also excludes an entire category of citizens. Those are American citizens who are American by birth, but are born overseas. Among other folks, that includes North Carolina's own J. Cole, who organized the Dreamville Hip Hop Festival. It also includes Adelia and Augustine Jackson, who are natural born citizens, but were born in the Republic of Korea. I urge all of y'all to vote for the bill.
Thank you, sir. And last, Ann Webb. Ann, you're recognized up to 1 minute. Please introduce yourself and any organization you represent.
Hi, my name is Ann Webb, Policy Director with Common Cause North Carolina. HB 1074 is an unnecessary waste of taxpayer funds. It is purely designed to divide voters with anti-immigrant conspiracy theories and create distrust in our democratic process. The law is already clear. There is no reasonable doubt that only U.S. citizens are eligible to vote in North Carolina. The language in our state constitution originates from the 14th Amendment, and its meaning has already been interpreted by the courts. It is already a federal and state felony to vote as a non-citizen or even to register. And there have been no efforts in our state to allow non-citizens to vote in local elections. All voters are required to verify their citizenship, and our amazing election system goes through a diligent process to verify that our voters are eligible. This is an attempt to spread lies that cast doubt on our elections and divide us, fostering an environment where prejudice and violence can thrive. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your comments. Members, that's all the people that we had sign up for the public. Representative Viler, I know that you want to make a motion, but Representative Harrison will recognize you, and Representative Warren one more time. Yes, Representative Harrison, you have the
thank floor. You, Mr. Chair. Just real quickly, I was thinking about what Representative Ball raised in her comments about the expense of educating the voters, and Representative Hall indicating that the state board was adequately funded, and I think maybe shorthanding what he said. But I do know that we had a lot of discussion, healthy discussion, in elections oversight a few weeks ago, maybe a month ago, and there are some real deficits in funding at the state board, and they indicated in the software and ability to maintain staff, there are all kinds of shortfalls. So I would just encourage those who are in charge of the appropriations process to, because this is the best thing we can do for a safe and a voting process that people can believe in, is to adequately fund the infrastructure of our election, including this new requirement. So thank you for that.
And Representative Warren, you wish to be recognized.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. You know, the House and the Senate are divided into committees, and each committee has a different charge. We are taxed upon to address existing problems in a lot of fields, from health care to election law. And if we concentrate on only those issues that are a problem today without addressing things that could become a problem tomorrow, if we would address them today, we would be in a pretty sorry state. So we have the capacity to address priorities as well as to prevent things from becoming priorities. Currently, there are three states that have laws allowing non-citizens to vote in state and local elections. There are eight additional states that have no impediments to non-citizens voting in local elections. I think we need to pass this bill so it doesn't become a problem that we have to address later. Let's nip it in the bud while it's simple to do and move on. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Representative Warren. Seeing no one else seeking recognition, Representative Eiler, you are recognized for a motion, sir.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I don't think this is going to cost any more to put this on the ballot than it does to put us on the ballot. But I move that House Bill 1074 be given a favorable report by this committee and referred to the wonderful Rules Committee.
Very good. Members, you've heard the motion for a favorable report and referral to Rules. All those in favor, please say aye. All those opposed, no. In the opinion of chair, the ayes appear to have it. The ayes do have it. Motion carries. Members, that is the only business that we have. Meeting's adjourned.
There you have it. Today at the NCGA, they discussed constitutional amendment, citizens only voting. So stay tuned for more developments to come. And please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter. Thanks for watching. See you next time.